drink him a water. It's been a while, hasn't it? Been a little bit since I've done one of these. Hugh Chefner's back with Rock and Rope. Been doing some crazy stuff, you know. New job, new drum set, new Dremel. Been putting holes in cymbals. Had a little crack there. Decided to add a little bit more flair, even out the hole distribution. It's one that I've had for years. By the way, I'm a drummer. I don't think I've even mentioned that on here. Maybe I have. Yeah. So, thought about it. Didn't really know what to do as far as concept for this show. Been putting some new scenage in the back there. Some new pictures of albums that are some of my favorites. Haven't completed it yet. I've got two strands. I've got a stack over here somewhere, more albums and some other ideas. This is the first show I'm gonna do. I do this in my garage, by the way. This is the first show I'm doing with the door open because it is now about 60 degrees and it's nice. It's spring, as you can see. Also, got a sunburn. I hang signs. I do signs, like the big lit signs, LED lights, and big channel letter signs and stuff like that. So I'm outdoors a lot. So between the sun and the wind here in the spring, here in good old northern Kentucky, northwestern Kentucky, I have a red face and red ears. I am not intoxicated. So that's just a little information for starters. Today, I really want to talk about, I'm really confused. I've confused myself as to what the exact subject matter is. But since I have the albums laid out before me, I'll go ahead. I guess Scott's been creeping in here lately to my psyche. Scott Weiland, one of my favorite singers. He died December 3rd, 2015. I'll never forget when I heard the news. It's kind of weird because I was scrolling through some pictures that I put up. There's a profile picture years ago, back in 11, I think. Actually, on that day, I made a picture of Scott Weiland, December 3rd, 2011, my profile picture. So it was really weird scrolling back seeing that, but it's not necessarily just a Scott Weiland appreciation video here on Rock and Robe. However, without Scott, I don't think a lot of music would have been shaped in the same manner. Two bands, actually, that Scott was in, I hold near and dear to my heart. When I was in high school, I remember I had this record here, Core, on cassette. Didn't really give it the time of day that I should have. Now that I'm older, I have a better appreciation for it. I've gone back and I've really listened to it. As one of the key elements of grunge that it is, it's a really heavy album. It laid the groundwork for what STP did and for, I think, honestly, a lot of other grunge artists and a lot of other bands for that era. Of course, the most notable albums, both of these all hold up together. Purple, which was definitely one of my favorite eras. And then I think Tiny Music, kind of, you know, it's their graduated version of what they were becoming. They're kind of a lounge band, and that was one of the things too, what I was talking about. Scott keeps creeping in to my stuff. Everybody knows how social media works. You know, stuff comes in as you see it, hear it, people talk about it. You click, it's clickbait, stuff like that. But you know, I listen to a lot of the same stuff and I watch a lot of the same stuff, so it just keeps kind of reverberating. But one thing I hadn't thought about a lot was Scott Weiland's little ditty with The Doors, where The Doors went on, I think it was VH1, and they had guest singers come in. Of course, you know, Jim Morrison's been dead for some time. I think, honestly, and I know there were other singers, but even Scott Stapp. I don't like to diss people or bands or music because I, you know, believe in, you know, everybody has a the ability to put their stuff out there, and they have their own ways to make music and their own options. But, you know, everybody makes fun of Nickelback, and then other people make fun of Creed. I will be the first to tell you, I had Creed's albums back in the day. I listened to Nickelback, so I'm not going to fluff it up and lie to you. But Scott Stapp got to do that stuff, too. But Scott Weiland, however, and I think Eddie Vedder did, too. But Scott Weiland, he blew the doors off that performance. 5-1 and Break On Through. Dude, if you haven't seen those performances, go to YouTube. You know, you're on it right now. Before you leave me, just subscribe, maybe like this, add a comment, whatever. But after you get done watching this, or, you know, come back, take a break, come back. You know, we're 6 minutes in, but you have to see that performance. Scott is the embodiment of Jim Morrison. He gets it. I mean, he really does get it. He ultimately met the same fate. I think the drugs got Jim the same way. They got Scott. Of course, Scott was in OD. I don't think so much that Jim Morrison was considered an OD, but I think his heart gave out because of all the drugs and the years of excess and craziness. But check out that performance. But there's so much more with Scott Weiland and STP. When I was in high school, like I said, Purple and Tiny Music were definitely two that I really gravitated towards. But number four, I'm just going to go right on into probably my favorite. Other than Purple and Tiny Music, number four really is my favorite. You know, you look on the inside, those suits they're wearing, that silver suit and those shoes that Scott was wearing, and all the guys, I mean, they have that lounge band, that like really cool, like 70s style, like eclectic, nostalgic, just really cool. They knew what they were into. They knew what they were doing. But some of my favorite things about them are the covers that they did, like Dancing Days, Led Zeppelin's Dancing Days, one of my favorite cover songs of all time. And then Andy's Chest. I mean, come on, dude, really? I mean, they were, and he mentions it, I think Scott mentions it on Tiny Music, you know, the Warhol kind of phase, that feeling, that era, that aesthetic, that, kind of brought in, like, I remember in the 90s, like, women were wearing bell bottoms and stuff. It kind of came back. That 70s show was one of those things, and everybody just kind of loved that era. And I don't know, I'm not saying they brought it in, but I'm saying that they did it well. They fit the mold for that kind of coolness. But see, that's the thing, is like everybody knows Scott Weiland for STP. And of course, I don't want to forget Shangri-La and the last album, Untitled, that Scott performed on with them in 2010. Great albums too, very solid albums, especially the last one. I don't think Shangri-La-Di-Da gets a lot of talk about. But I think it's a good album. Days of the Week is a really good song. Too Cool Queenie, of course everybody knows what the fuck that song's about. That song's about Courtney Love killing Kurt Cobain. But yeah, I love STP. I always have been a big fan of theirs. I remember in high school, may have been freshman, sophomore year, we were supposed to bring in a piece of music, a CD, a song, and talk about what it meant to you. And I don't know why I picked this song. It really has nothing to do with me. I guess I saw the depth of it, and I think I was trying to impress my teacher. But Church on a Tuesday, the fourth song on number four, talks about, you know, this kind of plastic life where people are going to church and, you know, people are smoking cigarettes and drinking too much, and people are other, you know, the same people that have the same problems but in a different light are telling other people. It's kind of cool, their insight and the way they did music. And speaking of Jim Morrison and the Doors, Atlanta, it's one of the softest songs I think that they ever kind of did, more laid back. It's in that Morrison set, that Doors kind of lounge band set. So check out that album. Check out STP if you haven't, and really dig deep in their albums, because their albums are really solid. They're really good albums. But then again, everybody knows Scott's not just known for STP. Scott is a really good singer, and Scott got to be with Velvet Revolver. Of course, Guns N' Roses fame. The band that was Guns N' Roses / Duff and Matt, they wanted to form this other rock band. Axl kept Guns N' Roses going, and so they put out a couple of albums, 2005 and I think 2007, I believe, was when I was in college after high school. I remember Contraband dropped in 2005. Great album. Love this song. And of course, it's so weird because I didn't realize this until a few months ago, but Slash, you know, member of GNR and Velvet Revolver, he was actually slated to be in Kiss, and I think that's how I learned this, is he was 17 and had a gig, or he was going to come in and try out for Kiss. He was 17, and they were like, nah, he's too young. But the reason why he was able to get kind of out there at 17 was his mom was David Bowie's person of the chick that sewed his clothes together or something, like art something in art and clothing. I think it was art director. I can't remember what exactly it was. I have to look that up again. But so I think that's kind of cool because Scott's a huge Bowie fan. And on Contraband, the last track, he actually stole Loving the Alien, a song title from a Bowie song title. I think it was on I want to say Pretty Monsters. I can't remember. It was an early 80s, late 70s album, like right before some of his crazy cool Thin White Duke stuff. But yeah, Velvet Revolver, I mean, they were definitely right up there, you know, as far as Scott stuff. And of course, being a big GNR fan, it was like the best of everything. And it was a new found realization how great Matt Sorum was as drummer. And then, you know, Duff and Slash and everybody in that band was clean and was trying to clean Scott up. And I don't think it worked out so well. I remember seeing some footage of him in court and get caught with some drugs. But for what it was worth, I mean, they tried their best and they put out two good albums. Libertad, also a really solid album. Pharrell, I believe, was the producer on that album. So both of those albums are really solid. Go check them out. Other stuff, as far as STP is concerned, and Scott Weiland. When I was in high school, I was just immersed with the idea of how great Scott Weiland was and is. You know, at the time it was is, now it is was. He's no longer living, it sucks. But I can do things like this to show my appreciation for such an artist. And he was a true, genuine artist, a great writer, great vocalist. He was the rock and roll dude. Like, he lived the lifestyle and sadly enough, died that way as well. But 12 Bar Blues, of course, everybody knows what, you know, that album cover is supposed to look like, or is a tribute to, which is cool. But this album is not a blues album. It is in a way, but it's not. It's really dirty. You know, songs like Barbarella. But I think his brother played drums on this, so another good reason to go listen to it. His brother passed away as well, I believe. Great album. Not like your STP or Velvet Revolver, is more laid back. It's Scott and, you know, friends of his playing musicians. And these are not like well-known musicians, like, you know, he didn't pull Alice Cooper to come in and sing or anything like that while he played guitar or some weird crap, you know, like Foo Fighters would do. Having Paul McCartney play drums on a track, he legit just wanted to go in there and make music. And that's kind of what he did. I have the double version of Happy in Galoshes. It's got some really cool tracks on it too. Missing Cleveland. It's a really good album if you're just in the mood to listen to Scott sing and get in his really, you know, his productiveness self, came out in that these two albums. It's not your like STP. You don't have the Deleo brothers. You don't have Eric in there. You don't have, you know, Slash and Duff doing crazy solos and hardcore thumping bass riffs and stuff like that. It's just, you know, Scott being creative. The last album that he put out, Blaster here, he tried to form a band, the Wildabouts. Can't remember which one it was. I believe it's this guy here, but he actually died the day the album was released. I think it was a drug overdose. And then I think he, other than this guy, Black, playing, I think, bass, basically reformed the band and went out on tour. Sexy Mexi, Joey Castillo was playing drums with him at the time when he passed away on tour. I believe they were in Ohio, which is kind of strange, missing Cleveland. I don't know. It's just, it's kind of like one of those things when you watch like an Unsolved Mysteries or a murder show and you see all the dots connected and you're like, there's a lot of weird stuff going on. Like, the stars are aligned here. But this also is a good album. Really, really good album, I think. It's probably one of my favorite albums. James Eha from Smashing Pumpkins actually makes an appearance, which is kind of cool that they were friends and, you know, doing that stuff back then. This is 2015. It feels like yesterday, but this is a while ago. 20th Century Boy covered that song in this album, so go check it out. It's a really good song. When my grandfather died that year, Circles, it's kind of a touching song, kind of got to me, made me cry a little bit when I was leaving the hospital as he died. Scott Weiland, folks. Again, I'm Hugh Hefner with Rock and Robe, and that's, you know, one of my core favorite singers. He and Chris Cornell of the grunge era. Of course, everybody loves Nirvana. I love Nirvana. I love Pearl Jam. I love all those normal mainstream grunge bands of the 90s. Grew up with that stuff, Soundgarden and stuff. But Scott Weiland doesn't get as much as Chris does as like the grunge recognition. I think they're a really great grunge band. But aside from that, you know, the guys from STP, they also, whenever Scott left, I think it was 2003 or something like that, 99, whenever he was doing 12 Bar Blues, they did this album with another singer called Talk Show. It's a great album. Go check it out. Army of Anyone. Ray Lazier is on this album. He is now the drummer of Korn and KMX with Doug Pinnick from King's X. And what's his name from... Dokken. It's a really great... super group there too, but this one is one of my favorite albums that came out around the time that we really needed great political music. And Richard Patrick is definitely one of those people. Richard Patrick is the singer of this band from Filter. He's really a level-headed person, and he tried to talk some sense into Scott too. Didn't work. I think Richard Patrick's been clean and sober for 20 some odd years now. And of course, you know, it's about making music, and that's kind of what this album made me realize, that it is about the music. And, you know, that whole rock star lifestyle, you can look like a rock star on stage, but if you're still looking like that and living like that off stage, it's not good for your health. Noah, his son, actually started a band with Slash's son and Robert Trujillo's son on guitar and bass or whatever. I think Robert Trujillo's son plays bass and then Slash's son plays drums. They had to kick him out because of drugs, and that's just sad. That continues down the beaten path of, you know, you think you're a rock star, so you got to do the drugs and the stupid shit. Because I know that was one of the things that got me. I was watching a documentary about Foo Fighters and Taylor Hawkins and Dave Grohl, you know, me being a drummer, I think, oh, these guys are fucking cool as hell. And you get up there and you start watching it and you're like, oh, Taylor Hawkins had an OD, and I didn't know that. So it's kind of sad. And he said the same thing I just said. You know, you you're a rock star on stage, you think you have to be that way off stage. And it's just sad. You know, it's sad that I'm having to sit here and look back at Scott, and I'm not looking forward to a new Scott with STP or Velvet Revolver album or both, or a solo album, because everything I think he did was pretty solid. I love all of that stuff. And it's sad to have to say this, because I was always a big STP fan and a big Scott with STP fan. I never really got into the Chester stuff, God rest his soul too, but I listen back now, a friend of mine has that, plays it at work, and I need to buy it. It's a really good album for an EP. He did some good stuff. Never really liked his voice so much, but with STP, it's like a new thing for him, and I really wish he was still alive too, because if Scott didn't want to do it, at least he could have done it, and I think he would have done it justice. However, in saying that, and I know I'm running long, I'm at 21 minutes here, but this is the first time in a long time that I've done rock and roll. I'm trying to come back and add some new flavor here in the spring. And been busy. Like I said, got a new drum set, new job. Hell, I got some new rims for my truck. Poked some holes in a cymbal, paid in some chairs today, got a sunburn. But I'm trying to really not talk about this, even though, because I feel like it's sacrilege. But Jeff Gutt's a really good singer. Okay, there I said it. I got it off my chest. I feel a little bit better. Jeff Gutt's a really good singer. I bought this, I think it was 2018, right? I used to be a police officer and I went to academy, and I listened to this album quite a lot. And it's funny because actually, my life has changed yet again. I'm no longer a cop, no longer with the same, partner, woman, that I was. And this album here is actually a really good album. It's a breakup album, and it almost heals a person when you listen to it, because there's even a song on there talking about it, The Art of Letting Go, and you just, sometimes you're not in the right place, you don't realize it, and you just have to let go. So this album really helped me with that, and Jeff is a great singer, this guy right here. And of course the Deleo brothers always never fail to surprise me with new stuff. They're really great. It's a great rock album, hard rocking album. Eric Kretz is still an amazing drummer as well. You know, they've got that retro attitude. They still have that rock, classic rock vibe, and now they are classic artists. So honestly, I support them. I think it's great. It's just like Alice in Chains. You know, Lane Dodd, William Duvall stepped in. Great albums they put out since the demise of Lane and the restructuring of their sound. So I feel like, you know, they don't have a lot of restructuring they have to do, because they just needed a really good rock singer. And Jeff is not Scott. He'll never replace Scott. No one would ever replace Scott. But Jeff is a really good singer. So check out this album. You know, it's right up there with everything else they did, because, you know, the DeLeo brothers, they're still kicking out the jams, and so is Eric Kretz. And it's still STP. It's just like Black Sabbath. After Ozzy left, they carried on the moniker of Black Sabbath with Dio and other singers. So it's not easy to get used to, but, you know, again, I always come back to Kiss, wearing a Kiss shirt, have Kiss behind me. They no longer have Ace and Peter in the band, you know, and it sucks, because I luckily got to see the four members, the original guys, do it, but sometimes you just have to pick up and carry on with the people who are left willing to continue on the dream. And I think even Bill Ward said the other day, drummer for Black Sabbath, the original drummer, and he, of course, left after that first album with Dio. He had some health, family issues, health issues, whatever. He even says nowadays, like Tommy Cleflos, he did the, you know, the end tour and all that. The last album, 13, was Sabbath with Ozzy. And he said he just doesn't have the chops to play live like that anymore. So sometimes you just have to know when to give in and give up. But these guys aren't done. The DeLeo brothers, STP, is not done. So let them do what they do. They're really good at it. And, you know, I listened to this. This came out when the pandemic hit last year, around this time. So it's a year old now, I think. Maybe a little bit before that. And they were planning a tour with Nickelback. I think that was who it was. Or Creed, or Three Doors Down. One of those bands that I really don't feel, or I don't really feel bad about saying I despise. But I get it. They're, you know, they came out around the same time, whatever. But yeah, Paradida, it's a really good album. It's an acoustic album, mind you. It's not your hard rocking, heavy, like you're not looking forward to like Three Cage Tigers or, you know, Vaseline or something crazy like that, or Plush. This is an acoustic album, and it's got some more heartfelt stuff on it. It's even got a song that I think Robert Deleo sings, I believe. And I think it's kind of his tribute to Scott. So it's really cool. And if you follow them on social media, they always pay tribute to Scott and Chester and friends of theirs who they lost. And they're really, I think they're really humble about who they are, what they are, and they're really just happy to make music. And that's kind of why I love these guys, and that's why I listen to them continually and will continue to. I mean, I'm looking forward to a new album. I don't know about you. I know that's kind of why I'm doing this, is hopefully somebody out there that doesn't know about this artist will go pick it up, because you should. Go listen to Scott's stuff. Go listen to Velvet Revolver stuff. Go listen to old stuff with Scott through STP. But you can't give up on a band just because, you know, the lineup's changed a little bit. So that's really all I have to say in Forrest Gump style about that. I'm Hugh Hefner. This is Rock and Robe. Go down below, subscribe, give me a like, whatever. Give me a comment. Tell me what you think about my show. I know it's just me talking and showing you pictures of album covers and talking about my favorite bands. You know, I've got a stack of CDs over here like this, and I still buy CDs, so I'm old. I get it, whatever. Make fun of me and give me some flack about that, whatever. But go check it out. All my other videos down below, up top, wherever they are on the screen as far as directional. And I'll see you here next time on Rock and Robe.